I want to start by asking you to tell everybody briefly about the partnership on AI.
Sure. Well, first of all, thanks so much for having me here. It's really exciting to be on this stage. The Partnership on AI is a nonprofit multi-stakeholder organization that was founded back in 2016, early 2017, by a lot of big tech companies, many of which were mentioned earlier, also including Facebook, Amazon, Apple, IBM, Microsoft, Google. And today we are a coalition of over 80 member organizations spanning industry, including those companies and several others, civil society, advocacy organizations, and academia. And we're globally based, so we're on four continents, doing work in over 11 countries now, I think, and really working to drive the development of research and best practice generation for the responsible use and deployment and development of artificial intelligence technologies.
So one of the first words you used was multi-stakeholder. You mentioned mm-hmm. some of the big technology companies who were the driving force behind founding the organization.
Yep.
Talk about some of these non-corporates and what role they play.
Yeah, sure. So our board actually is comprised equally of for-profit and non-profit entities. So the American Civil Liberties Union is on our board, the MacArthur Foundation, OpenAI, which is a 501c3 themselves, and several academics. And the membership itself is comprised of a really broad range of diverse organizations. So we have organizations representing interests in rights and liberties, interests in privacy and data ethics, interests in law and interests in underrepresented communities. There are a host of academic institutions and laboratories that focus on AI and machine learning specifically, but also on questions of law and policy frameworks for a lot of the big issues at hand in this space. So our hope really is to kind of mush all those perspectives together in a way that really effectively addresses questions which we think are inherently multidisciplinary, right? So issues related to the future of work, safety and security, ethics, privacy, et cetera.
So I want to get into your actual work in a moment, but first, multi-stakeholder, but what about governments?
Mm-hmm. So we actually don't have any public agencies directly involved in our work. That's simply because it makes it a more level playing field for us to engage with governments on equal footing, and there's different jurisdictional rules based on where you are for participating in outside advisory councils that one might perceive us to look a lot like.
You'll talk to them
yes,
and with them, but
right.
they won't be driving what you're doing.
Right. Well, I think we're really interested in seeing that be a conversation, right? So it's sort of a two-way street. We talk a lot with global, policymakers in here in Asia, in the U.S., in Europe, Canada, all sorts of other places all the time. We try to be helpful resource in answering their questions about the state of technology, where we see the big questions going, what the state of regulatory affairs ought to look like, and certainly I think we're really interested in being informed by the global policy work we see happening as well.
And I want to tease the audience by answering up front one reason I think answers the question of why are you here. You recently signed an impressive member who is not, the company is not Western. Tell everybody about that new member, your newest member, I guess.
Sure. So Baidu was our first Chinese company to join the organization. We announced that about a month ago now, I think. We're really enthusiastic about becoming as globally representative as possible. So that represents a big step for us, I think, in making sure that we have the right voices at the table.
Great. Now, you've already heard this morning that AI is the number one lens through which I think our version of the business community is talking about the future of business. Mm. Let's get right to what you hope to accomplish. What is your group doing? And we've joked, you're not a think tank, you're not an advocacy organization, you're not a technical organization per se. What are you? What are you doing?
Sure. Well, so, it's not that we're not technical. I think that's actually a really important point to make. We were founded by the heads of AI research at those big companies that I named at the beginning of this conversation. So those individuals really came together at the beginning of our work to found this institution out of a mutual interest that they all had identified in answering a lot of these questions in an environment that would allow them to do so in a multidisciplinary way and in a way that allowed them to tug at different areas of expertise outside of their home companies. And so the fact that we were founded by like the world's, some of the world's leading global AI research scientists, I think, is just part of our DNA. And one of our theories of change is really that, you know, there's a special sort of empowerment and power actually that engineers and developers, especially in these large companies, can bring to bear in making sure that AI technology is developed in a responsible manner. And they can't do it alone, right? So that, hence all the other actors we have involved in the work that we do. And from a product perspective, really, which gets to the question that you
Your
asked.
Your product, yeah.
You know, we're working right now on a set of research outputs, actually, which will probably start becoming available for public consumption in early 2019. So we're looking forward to that moment. Those products have been worked on by our whole community. So all 80 organizations are involved in what we call a set of working groups. And they span a whole range of topic areas, some of which I mentioned before. We have a working group on safety critical artificial intelligence.
I'm sorry, say that again, safety?
Safety critical artificial intelligence.
Explain what that, explain why, what's, what AI means to safety and critical applications.
Sure. Well, so actually, you know, there's been a lot of conversation today about the question of safety. It can comprise questions of security, cybersecurity, physically manifested safety, as in the case of self-driving cars, for example. But it also might mean socioeconomic security and security of other kinds, depending on how it's interpreted. And this group is looking at that whole range of issue sets. And one of the work products that they're developing is actually a database of safety incidents, basically failures of AI to operate correctly in certain environments. And our hope really is that that will become a research resource to the community and publicly available. So that's an example of a work product.
So that's very interesting. The airline industry put that together as an industry consortium of their incidents so that they can share and learn.
Mm-hmm.
If you're saying if you're successful, your member companies, as an example, want to have a reliable database of AI incidents, problems that can occur so that they can study them together rather than in silos.
Yeah, that's absolutely right.
What about in the areas of bias and, you know, workplace issues? There's this pop culture meme that the robots are going to take over our jobs.
Mm-hmm.
What is the role of a group of scientists working together on that subject?
Yeah, so that's another area of our work, actually. We have a working group right now on what we call AI, labor, and the economy. And that set of issues is really, it's I think, taking a uniquely global perspective and thinking about those future work questions that you raised. You know, there's a lot of the academic community right now is focused on trying to figure out the timescale of change caused in the labor market based on automation, you know, trying to predict in certain ways what the fallout of such technological change might mean for workforces. And one of the projects that we're working on is actually in taking a case study approach, actually, and looking at real on-the-ground examples for how firms have deployed automation and seen change affect their organizations in a whole host of different ways, positive and negative. And I think what we're finding is that oftentimes you see these the questions that we're asking, the answers to them come in the form of trade-offs, actually. Instead of purely positive or negative, you kind of see a sliding scale of evolution in the way that automation affects workforces and companies themselves. And it's really hard, actually, to say either in a black or white, right or wrong sort of way, whether things are good or bad, just that they're different in certain ways. And so our hope is really to provide a little more nuanced perspective to some of the arguments unfolding in the labor space.
If I think about our last panel talking about essentially West-China tension on trade, is it possible we'll also have a bifurcation in approaches to artificial intelligence? So, and just to simplify it, mm-hmm. China has one approach, the West has another approach, and what will, if that happens, what will be the ramifications for trying to have standards, which is what your group is trying to do?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, you know, I'm actually sort of two minds on this question. I think if you look at the data, and another one of my sort of side projects has been sitting on the steering committee of the AI Index, which is a project of Stanford University's AI 100 collaboration. And for a couple years now, we put out a report which indexes progress, technical progress in the AI field. And this year, we're releasing a report that updates some of the work that we've done in the past. And it intersects pretty deeply with the work of the Partnership on AI because, you know, a lot of the conversations that are being had rely on us looking at the sort of the cold hard facts, right, of the way that the industry is developing. And if you look at the data in the publication world, there's actually a tranche of information being shared coming out of the Chinese research sector, you know, with the global research environment. I think that this past year, there were record-breaking numbers of paper submissions to some of the biggest AI and machine learning paper conferences in the world. China exceeded the US in ICML and AAAI submissions, I think, for the first time. And you really see this incredibly thriving, globally collaborative AI research community in the research sector. And I think that that's also true to a certain extent of industry as well, where there's a lot of horse trading that happens between companies at the senior executive level. You know, talent frequently cycles through through a number of different companies, and so you end up with this group of friends, essentially, right, who
yep.
all grew up in the field together, and I think that incites a spirit of collaboration as well. But I do worry that the narratives that we're seeing generated by the popular media, and, you know, we've talked about it today here on the stage, too, of a sort of a bipolar sort of, you know, stance developing in the technical community is it's a worry that people have for good reasons, and I think part of what we're trying to work on is avoiding that.
And you make a fascinating point. It's analogous, I think, to the medical research world, that whatever else is going on, scientists share their information with each other for the good of science, and that's happening, period.
Right.
But let's take an example. A very easy one for many people to understand is China feels ahead of the U.S. in using AI on facial recognition technology. It's being deployed at multiple jurisdictions in China, and the knee-jerk Western civil liberties response is that's very concerning.
Mm-hmm.
How might the Partnership on AI deal with a subject like that?
Sure. Well, so, you know, we're in the business of productive disagreement, right? So
productive disagreement.
You know, I really think actually airing better and more nuanced understandings of cultural, jurisdictional, political, policy differences in the environments in which the different organizations that we work with operate, and in the products and the values that they develop themselves, I think is really important to what I see as a really global and human project mm-hmm. of getting this all right. And you know, I think facial recognition in particular is a really interesting example because even in the US you see extremely divergent perspectives among, you know, industrial research organizations and companies, and even advocacy organizations, frankly, on the subject of where, when, why, how appropriate use related questions, right? So I think that it's a useful exercise for an organization like us to really try to tease out all the threads of those different arguments.
I'm going to come to the room in a moment, but before I do, looking at this room, what do you need from these people? What do you want from them?
I mean, I think the biggest call to action coming from an organization like ours is just that, you know, building technology in the right ways is a really participatory, collaborative exercise. And I think that extends to into some of the conversations that were had earlier from this stage about the government and industry. That needs to be a collaborative bridge as well as organizations across sectors and within the same sector working with each other. So
your members are some of the biggest, best-known companies and organizations in the world. Do you need startups as well and you know, little companies that are going to be big companies?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this is an all-hands-on-deck effort.
Your questions. I'm going to keep going if you don't, but I'd be delighted to know if you have any. Gary Richel, Silicon Valley venture capitalist, spent a lot of time in China, said a moment ago that I'm going to paraphrase him. No one in the government really understands technology, and that includes the last five administrations. Mm. You can speak to that. Tell everybody why.
Well, I worked in the Obama administration before taking on this role at the partnership. I was in the White House, working in the Office of Science and Technology Policy, and you know, I both agree and disagree with that to a certain extent. I think that
that's a good Washington technique.
Well, it's true, I actually think, and you know, I'll be somewhat self-critical in saying this, but you know, government. One of the biggest deficiencies of government is that there isn't sufficient technical understanding implicating the policy matters that public policymakers are working on. And I think that was a huge issue that the Obama administration tried to grapple with by actually bringing technologists from industry and the academic research field into government for tours of duty. But I think we've got a lot further to go. And I think we've seen that not just in the US, we've seen that in other jurisdictions. And I think it is one of the single most important things I think that the public sector can do to prepare itself for what's coming.
I want to end on not on policy but on language. There's already been a handful of amusing and interesting comments today about what artificial intelligence means and what Internet of Things means and how else we might talk about it. You told me when we first met that you feel like on the use of the expression AI, we're in a Tower of Babel moment. You also said you might have called your organization something different. Tell everybody what that is and why you said that.
Oh, well, so, you know, we purposefully avoided having the first project of the partnership on AI being defining what artificial intelligence actually means, because there is such a range of definitions, even within just the technical community. But we joke all the time internally that we may as well call ourselves the partnership on statistics, multivariate statistics, basically.
Multivariate statistics?
Because it's just, you know, I mean, saying it's just math is obviously extremely oversimplifying it.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of hype right now to contend with, and I think in 5 years we might be questioning what we ought to have called ourselves instead of the partnership on AI.
But do you think that, I mean, how important is that topic of are we understanding each other? So will we lay people, I'm putting myself in that category, I don't know about you, will we be talking about artificial intelligence 5 years from now as a discipline?
I think so. I mean, it's been a discipline certainly for a lot longer than that. AI has a short commercial history, but a very long research history, or a relatively more long research history. But I think to answer your question directly, I mean, I think the point of translation and common language is really, really important. I think that, and this is, you know, a central part of the work that the partnership is doing as well, getting philosophers and economists and anthropologists and sociologists and computer scientists to really all be able to talk to each other in a similar set of terms, so that they're really making sure that there is cross-disciplinary understanding is going to be really crucial. And I think that extends equally to talking to members of the public about this technology. It's really, consumer education is going to be incredibly important, just as important as educating policymakers, as I said before, and making sure that everyone's clear about what we're talking about and what's at stake accordingly is going to be crucial.
Well, speaking to my bias, I'm pro-philosopher, and so I'm glad you included them. And Terah, I'm glad you took time to be with us today. Thank you.
Thank you.